Ahead of congressional testimony from special counsel Robert Mueller, new reporting alleges former UN ambassador Samantha Power participated in anti-Trump rhetoric using her government email account. This may sound familiar. Text messages between former FBI employees Peter Strzok and Lisa Page became a central part of the allegations that the investigation into Russian collusion was nothing more than a witch hunt. Hill TV's Executive Vice President John Solomon joins me now to explain more. John, first of all, let's begin with Samantha Power and her role in the Russia investigation. It goes all the way back to 2016.
It does.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, and actually it's unusual because you wouldn't expect the UN ambassador to have anything to do with a counterintelligence investigation. Normally the UN ambassador's job is not an intelligence designated job. But what we learned about a year ago is that she had made hundreds of requests during the 2016 election to unmask American names in NSA intercepts. Let's talk about what unmasking is, because
yes,
it's a term that a lot of Americans don't know. When you're accidentally intercepted by the NSA, the Constitution protects your identity. The default position of the United States government is, if we intercept you in the NSA, people can't see your name or what you said. And intelligence professionals make those decisions every day, that your name, we accidentally intercepted your name, it shouldn't be revealed to anyone in the U.S. government, and they keep it deleted, redacted. Then someone in a political position like Samantha Power has the ability to use her authority and say, I want to see that American's name, even though the professional intelligence officer decided that that wasn't necessary for the intelligence product. That practice has been growing in leaps and bounds. Between 2013 and 2016, it went up 300%. And just last year, it went up another 70% under Donald Trump. I just got these new numbers. So 16,700 Americans last year had their name unmasked over the recommendation or against the recommendation of an intelligence professional. A lot of people in Congress, the ACLU, lots of people are concerned about this practice. No one has been able to explain, including Samantha Power, why she unmasked so many names, hundreds of names, more than one a day during the election. What she told congressional investigators last summer is, I didn't ask for a lot of these names, and I don't know how my name got to be used. It's obvious my name was used.
Which is even more concerning.
Yeah, right? But it means there's a looseness in the system.
Yes.
We know some of the names that were unmasked were Trump officials, particularly in the post election period, when we were in the transition period. I believe Devin Nunes has said there were dozens of times that Trump transition officials were unmasked. People are trying to get to the bottom of this. Now come these new documents. And just like Pete Strzok and Lisa Page, who had their own theory of what was going on with the Trump election and bashing him and using all these names, smelly Walmart shoppers, things like that. You see in these emails some significant anti-Trump rhetoric by Power and her assistants and the people she's corresponding with in the
What are the nature of those?
Well, you know, some of them are pretty strong words. There are words like repugnant moral bully.
Right.
There are a lot of discussion about using TV appearances, speeches, a 60 Minutes appearance at the end of the administration to try to counter Trump and to shame Trump on immigration or other of his policies. So what you really see is in government emails where no politics is supposed to be involved, a political effort to try to shame Trump, to tease him, demean him in these emails. Very, very similar to the text
messages. Could this be a Hatch Act violation?
It's one of the questions that congressional investigators are saying. They want to look at this for a couple of reasons. One, was her anti-Trump bias in any way a motive for any of the unmaskings for her or her staff? How did her name get used? That's one question. The second question is the question we just learned with Kellyanne Conway, which is when you engage in political rhetoric on government resources and government, it can potentially be an Hatch Act violation. Mark Meadows says he's looking at that. The original House intelligence investigators and Senate intelligence investigators were very interested when I contacted them last night about these emails, and they want to know, is this a new motive? Is this a new element layer to the unmasking of Sarah Powell that was done under her name?
Much more is there to this story? Is this just the tip of the iceberg? We still don't know a lot about those unmasking.
Right.
Which of her staff was doing that, which other intelligence professionals?
There is a big, giant hole in this narrative. And as you said earlier, it goes to a concerning question. Is the system so loose that any person can unmask? Was Donald Trump targeted for unmasking, something he alleges he was spied on? These are questions that have not yet been answered. And meanwhile, while we've been dancing around this for 2 years, there's a sudden spike in unmasking again, 70% spike in 2018 in unmasking. This should concern anyone who's concerned about civil liberties, the Fourth Amendment, the Constitution, and we don't have good answers yet.
Well, it goes to the central matter of what we're looking at. I'm sure John Solomon is going to be bringing us a lot more on this. Thanks, John.
Thanks, Sagar.
We'll have more Rising for you after this.